Happy Thanksgiving to all of you. My name is Pastor Kyle Winter, and I am the pastor at the church at Creston Lutheran. And, usually, I guess, when I'm here to do something, I'm looking out at a bunch of kindergartners through, eighth graders. But this is my first opportunity to be able to preach to you all on a first service. So thanks for inviting me to do so. And I'm very glad to be joining you for our Thanksgiving service today. I guess just maybe a few notes for your service today, that during the time of prayers, we will be we won't be using kind of formula prayers, but you'll be offering things that you are thankful for, and I'll be taking those and lifting them up to God with you all and giving thanks for them. So you can be thinking about, as we kind of offer things that we are grateful for over this past year, you can be considering those to offer during our time of prayer. We're not using any screens or anything like that, so you're using your hymnals for singing hymns, which is, I'm sure, you guys are accustomed to and used to. I made my congregation do this last night. I said, we're not using any screens or anything like that, so you're singing out of your hymnals. And they were all fiddling around, remembering how to use their hymnals. So today's going to be a great mix of recalling the truths of the faith through the creed. We'll be reciting all of Luther's, the meanings in the small catechism to the creed. We'll also be singing, we get to sing a bunch of hymns, which is very wonderful to me, and then we get to meditate on the idea and the call for Christians to give thanks in all circumstances, which is a wonderful and important call for us. I used to have a dear friend of mine who was an older man, wise Christian mentor of mine, and he used to tell me consistently in life when I would bring him problems and challenges, he would say, Kyle, thanksgiving and gratitude is always the correct response. Like, there's never a bad time to be grateful and thankful for what God has done, even as much as we might struggle with that at times. Gratitude and thanksgiving is always the correct response. So let's begin our time by standing, and we will sing together hymn 829, Come Ye Thankful People, Come.
Song of harvest.
We gather in the name of the Father. You made us, O God. We gather in the name of the Son. You saved us, O God. We gather in the name of the Holy Spirit. You gave us faith and help us lead godly lives, O God. Thank you. Amen. What is the first article of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. What does this mean? I believe that God has made me and all creatures, and that he has given me my body and soul, eyes and ears, and all my members, my reason and all my senses, and still takes care of them. He also gives me clothing and shoes, food and drink, house and home, spouse and children, land, animals, and all I have. He richly and daily provides me with all that I need to support this body and life. This is most certainly true. Let's sing together, We Praise You, O God, hymn 785. Be seated for the reading of the Word of God this morning. Our first reading comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verses 1 through 10. This is the instructions of the Lord to the people prior to their entrance into the promised land, in preparation for the good gifts that God would give them. Deuteronomy 8, verses 1 through 10. Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land that the Lord promised on oath to your forefathers. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years, to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in his way and revering him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with streams and pools of water, with springs flowing in the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley and vines and fig trees and pomegranates, olive oil and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land that he has given you. This is the word of the Lord. Our second reading comes from the Apostle Paul, book of Philippians, chapter 4, verses 6 through 20. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition and with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstance. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of contentment in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Yet it was good for you to share in my trouble. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you only. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid again and again when I was in need. Not that I'm looking for a gift, but I'm looking for what may be credited to your account. I have received full payment and even more. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gift you sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. And my God will meet all of your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel this morning. Our gospel text comes from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. And they stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was being healed, he came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to thee, O Christ. Let's sing together hymn 782, "Gracious God, you send great blessings." Mm-hmm. Well, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Again, happy Thanksgiving to you all. It is a good thing. I love Thanksgiving as a holiday, as a day to pause and do the thing that we should all be doing all the time as Christians in giving thanks. I'd like to consider today the topic of Thanksgiving as it runs throughout the scriptures and how it might be, how we can understand it in a greater kind of breadth. I've entitled the sermon today, The Anatomy of Thanksgiving. So as in anatomy of anything, anatomy is just the study of the component parts that make up the whole, okay? So you have like an anatomy of your body that acknowledges all the individual parts, the muscles, the fingers, the hands, that make up the whole of the body, okay? And if you were to look through scripture, I think that you would also see that when it comes to the topic of Thanksgiving, okay? When it comes to the topic of Thanksgiving, the scriptures have a lot to teach us about Thanksgiving and the kind of component parts of what make up the act, the simple act, but the profound act of Thanksgiving that Christians alike, that all of us are called to be regularly giving thanks, okay? So I have, maybe six component parts to Thanksgiving that I want to consider and think about today. It may be helpful if you have a Bible in front of you to open it and work through some of the passages. We'll be in the Psalms for a lot of it, for about four of the points that I'll make, and then in the New Testament for two of the points I'll make. But when it comes to the component parts of Thanksgiving, I would say that the very first thing that we should acknowledge about Thanksgiving is that Thanksgiving has an origin to it, okay? The act of Thanksgiving and gratitude in general has an origin to it. So you probably have, in your lifetime, been in the practice of sometime during Thanksgiving Day, gathering around your table and somebody asking the question, what are you thankful for? Okay? And everybody goes around and answers that question. So when I was a kid, we would all gather at my grandfather's house, and he had this big, huge table that he was insistent that we all sit at the same table. And we would stretch out this whole table, and we would all eat our meal. And by the end of our meal, he would ask us to go around the table, every grandchild, every aunt and uncle, all the parents, all the grandparents. We would sit, and we would say, what are you thankful for? And we'd go around the circle and share. Okay? And those are good practice. And you've probably done that too. But what I'm always interested to see is how we so regularly will talk about what we're thankful for, but not acknowledge where it came from or whom it came from, whom those good gifts came from. So who you're thankful to. And the scriptures will acknowledge us all the time, almost any time that's talking about Thanksgiving, it will always acknowledge the origin of that thing for which you're giving thanks. And probably one of my favorite passages in scripture about this subject is James 1:17, where James tells us this. He says, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadows. Okay? And he's just very clearly and very explicitly telling you that Thanksgiving has an origin to it. Every good and perfect gift that you have received and that I have received over the last year came from somewhere. And ultimately, it found its origins in God himself, okay? That he is the first and greatest giver of every good gift that you and I have. So I would commend to you this Thanksgiving, if you're gathering around at your table and you're eating your turkey and your mashed potatoes and your green bean casserole, which is my personal favorite of all of the Thanksgiving things, and you're considering what you're very thankful for, don't skip the step of also thinking who you're thankful to for those things. Because ultimately, every good and perfect gift comes from above, from God himself. And it also comes through people, Right? So not only can you give thanks to God for all these good gifts, but you can also give thanks for the people and the individuals and the hands and those people who gave you and who brought those gifts to you. Right? Because you serve in a vocational capacity as the hands and feet of God in the world, okay? Bearing his gifts to others. And when you see that in other people, it's good to give thanks to God as the ultimate origin, but also the people and individuals that he worked through to give you those good gifts, okay? So that's the first kind of piece of the anatomy of thanksgiving, is that it has an origin, okay? Now the next piece is the one we just talked about, but we'll think about it a little bit more, is that thanksgiving also has a reason, okay? A reason for being thankful. And Psalm 136 is the very best for this, because it's just a long list of reasons for which to be thankful. Psalm 136, you all know it, really. I mean, once you begin to hear it, you realize, oh, yeah, this is a great song. So Psalm 136 tells us this. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, his love endures forever. Who by his understanding made the heavens, his love endures forever. Who spread out the earth upon the waters, his love endures forever. And if you were to go through that entire psalm, it's just a big old list of reasons why we should give thanks. Right? It goes kind of through all the kind of attributes and actions and history of God. It says, for these various reasons, let us give thanks. But you'll notice the recurring theme that says over and over and over again that the psalmist comes back to. Give thanks to God, for his love endures forever. That at the very end of the day, the one reason that we ultimately always have cause to give thanks is because the love of God endures day after day, age after age, year after year in our lives. And we have a testimony to that in the past year. Okay? So thanksgiving has an origin, a reason, but it also has a response to it too. Okay? A response to it. And Psalm 107 is very wonderful for this. So Psalm 107, reminds us of this. It says, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, his love endures forever. So you have there the origin, the reason, but then it says this. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, those whom he redeemed from the hand of his foe. In verse 20 and 21, it'll say, let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men. Let them sacrifice thank offerings and tell of his works with songs of joy. What the psalmist is telling you is that if you have acknowledged the origin of thanksgiving and acknowledged that you have a reason for thanksgiving, we can all say, I'm very thankful for this. But what are you going to do with that, right? Like, what does that lead you to? And the psalmist will remind you, like, he gives you all sorts of things. He says, let your thanksgiving result in song. Let your thanksgiving result in words, in actions, in offerings, in service to other people. I mean, you see this kind of over and over and over again in the scriptures, this idea that those who are thankful have a reaction and a response. So we can say, yes, I'm thankful. But what does that lead you to? What sort of life, what sort of action, what sort of response does that call you forth to? I think that's a beautiful and important question for us to consider. You know, just like anecdotally, thankfulness has all sorts of benefits and to it. That we should, like, just the very action of gratitude, the mindful sort of awareness of the various benefits that we have in life. It's one of the greatest virtues, and it has all sorts of good things that it brings about in our life. So to consider the origin, the reason, and the response that we have to thanksgiving, there are benefits that come from just doing and taking on the action of being grateful. I was thinking this week even about some of the benefits of gratefulness medically that you see. Okay, so and I was looking at some kind of research online that was, and summarizing, it would say that grateful people tend to be individuals who are more empathetic, tend to be people who are more forgiving, people who have reasons for their gratefulness. Okay, tend to have a more positive outlook on life. Grateful individuals demonstrate less envy and less materialism, and less self-comparison. Thankfulness improves self-esteem and enhances relationships, the quality of sleep and the longevity of life, just the simple act of Thanksgiving. I mean, if Thanksgiving was like put into a pill form, it would be like the new miracle drug. And we don't think about that, right? That just the simple act of the origin, the reason, the response to Thanksgiving brings about all sorts of healthy and good things in our life. God knew what he was doing when he kept calling his people to be thankful and to show gratitude in response to his gifts. So it has an origin, a reason, a response. If Psalm 107 were to teach us something else, though, too, I think it would teach us an important lesson. That Thanksgiving also has a history to it as well. So if you were to just take an analysis of Psalm 107, Psalm 107 does an interesting thing. So it gives like a history of God's gracious actions as a call to a response of gratefulness, okay? So it says in Psalm 107, verse 4, it'll say, some people wandered in deserts and wasteland, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty. Their lives ebbed away. They cried out to the Lord for help, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. So let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds to men. He goes on in verse 10 to say, some sat in darkness and in the deepest gloom, prisoners of suffering in iron chains, for they rebelled against the word of God and despised his counsel. So he subjected them to bitter labor. And they cried out to the Lord, and he saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness and out of the deepest gloom. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds to men. I mean, do you hear what the psalmist is doing? He's just beginning to recall the history of the people of God and say, think back. Remember the faithfulness of God over your life and let that lead you to thanksgiving. Yes, maybe the year is tough. Maybe the moment right now is hard, but think back. Remind yourself of the faithfulness and enduring love of God over the generations and let that call you now to thankfulness and gratefulness to God. As an example of how to do this, and a good and easy way to practice the remembrance of the history of God's faithfulness to you, you all have this one of these or multiple of these in your house, I guarantee it. Some of you have organized them very nicely into albums and things like that. Some of them are just sitting in massive boxes with dust on them. And there are boxes of pictures, okay? Boxes of pictures from throughout your life that you like organize and you always intend to do something with, but you just stuff them in a box eventually and they sit someplace. And you sort of think like, oh man, that's gonna be a big project because there are thousands of pictures that we'd have to go through. And every once in a while, you'll get out those boxes and you'll dust them off and you'll open them and you'll begin to flip through all the pictures, right? And have you ever noticed what happens when you do that? You'll open up, and it's like addictive to do, right? You'll be flipping through the pictures, and you'll sit with somebody, and you'll think, oh, do you remember that day? Do you remember that anniversary? Do you remember this person? Do you remember when we went there? Do you remember when she died? Do you remember when he got married? Do you remember when she was born? Do you remember when we did this? And you're flipping through these pictures. And what they become, and usually your like kind of heart is like filled with gratitude in the moment. And filled with like sort of happiness. Because what are you doing? Those are all moments in times where you saw fit to take a picture because of like the goodness of God in that very moment. And to flip through those pictures is just a Psalm 107. where you're reminding yourself of the history of faithfulness in your life that God has given to you. And I would call you to do the very same thing that Psalm 107 does, where it says, after it remembers, it says, let us give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and for his wonderful deeds to men. As you flip through the memories of life, remembering that Thanksgiving is also tied to history, that God's actions graciously in your life are tied to history, okay? Maybe you'll do that today. Maybe you'll do that this coming weekend as you open up the boxes of history and remember and recall God's faithfulness to you in your life. Thankfulness not only has a history, but it also has a future too. And Psalm 9 is a very good reminder to me of this. And as I read it, I'll just read a couple verses to you. But Psalm 9 is wonderful for this because of the tenses. I want you to pay attention to the tenses that the verbs are. I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your works. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to you, O Most High. Just consider those two verses. And consider how all of the tenses of those verbs are in the future tense. I will praise you. Okay? I will give thanks to you. I will honor you. I will give thanks. It's like making a decision in the future that you are choosing to be a thankful person and show gratitude and thanksgiving for the things that God has done, is doing, and will do in the future. In some ways, ultimately, Thanksgiving just comes down to a choice. I mean, you can choose to look at the world and be pessimistic and angry and upset and dissatisfied and discontent. Or you can choose to look at the past and the present and the future and say in your heart and make a decision in your mind to say, I will give thanks. I will give thanks. I will be a person of thanksgiving. I will remind myself of the origin and the reason, the response, and the history of God's thankfulness, of God's graciousness to me, and I will give thanks in the future, okay? This is a great day. Today, I don't know what you guys have gone through. I know as a country and as a nation, as a world, we have gone through a hard and challenging year. But that doesn't mean that we should just throw up our hands and just be discontent and angry. But instead, to turn and with Psalm 9 say, I will give thanks to the Lord because of his unfailing love to us. So, there's an origin, a reason, a response, a history, a future. But lastly, I would say that that Thanksgiving also has an enemy. It has an enemy to it. And the enemy of Thanksgiving, generally speaking, comes in the form of two words. And the words are, if only. Here's what I mean. I'll give you some examples. If only I were thinner, I'd have the good life. If only I were richer, I'd have the good life. If only my kids would come. If only my kids would go. If only I could leave home or move home or get married or stay single. If only my skin were clear of pimples, my calendar free of people. If only my profession were immune to layoffs, then I would have the good life. Right? I mean, you can go on and on and on with the if onlys in life, right? If only the world weren't so tough, if only I didn't lose my job, if only so many people weren't sick, if only life weren't so challenging right now, if only I weren't so lonely or my health weren't so bad right now. The if onlys can run forever. But ultimately, you have to respond to the if onlys with something because they'll wreck your life if you don't. Okay? They'll wreck your life, your perspective, who you are. They'll wreck your future, your past. It'll wreck everything. And if I were to implore you to answer, because we all go through the if-onlys, if I were to implore you to do something with the if-onlys, I would tell you to respond to it with 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 17. This is the Apostle Paul's words to the church in Thessalonica. And they are profound and challenging, and none of us do them very well. Every time I read these passages, I think I am so lame at doing what the Apostle Paul says in this passage. But it is the antidote to the if-onlys in our life and in our culture. The Apostle Paul says this: be joyful always, pray continuously, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Paul's antidote to the if-onlys is to say, find joy, pray, and give thanks for every bit of it. But how on earth can we do that? Like with the challenging moments in life, with the suffering and hardship and the many if-onlys that we go through, how can we give thanks for the obvious areas of lack? I think that Christ Jesus and his cross would teach us something about this. That even in the moments of suffering, even in the moments of hardship, even in the moments where our hopes and dreams were sort of shattered, that God can and is always up to something good for those who trust in his name and those who follow him. Right? That's what the cross teaches us. That at the very moment of the worst event in history, the most unjust event in history, the saddest event in history, the most terrible event in history, God was up to something good, redeeming the world, forgiving the world. And the cross teaches us that even in the moments where all of our hopes and dreams are shattered, that even in those moments, God is up to something good. And that means that our hearts can maintain a sense of gratitude in all things. So maybe you've never thought or considered the anatomy or the kind of component parts of Thanksgiving. But I would call you today and in the weeks and months to come, as Christians, do not forget that your Thanksgiving has an origin, it has a reason, it has a response, it has a history, it has a future, it has an enemy, and it also has an antidote in Christ Jesus, in whom we can find thanksgiving for all things. And that is God's will for you, now, today, tomorrow, and forever. Would you please rise, and we will join together, and we will sing to the Lord of the harvest, hymn 893. Thank you. second article of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. What does this mean? I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from all eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed me, a lost and condemned person, purchased and won me from all sins, from death and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood and with his innocent suffering and death. Time of prayer and thanksgiving now, and it's filled with the content of your own personal thanksgivings for the year. And so I'd invite you to share now. You can just raise your hand with things or situations or things that happen that you are thankful for today, and we will pause for a brief moment at each one of them and give thanks for them. So have that. Let's hear our thanksgiving. Yeah. For health and the blessings of God, we thank you, O Lord. Absolutely. Others? Yeah.
I thank God for all of you, our church, and we've remained to stay together through this time, and just praise God for how he's taking care of us.
For the maintaining of unity in the church and in this body of believers, we're very thankful. We praise God for that. Amen. Others? Yeah. To think that we get to go to school and have amazing teachers, all these simple things that we thank and praise God for. Amen. Others? That's right. God's endless grace and mercy that he grants to each one of us in and out of season all the time that he gives to us without end. Absolutely. Amen. Any others? For his loving kindness and compassion, we praise and thank God for that too. Amen. Yeah.
I thank God for his grace every day in our lives, and also for God has blessed us with 27 years of wedded bliss today.
For God's endless grace and mercy, not only in general to our lives, but also to your marriage for 27 years, we give thanks and praise to God for that. Amen. Yeah. Yes.
Yes, thank God for the Holy Spirit that's always available, and we can have a relationship with the Holy Spirit.
That's right, for guiding us and blessing us with his gifts and living inside of us and guiding his church, calling us to a relationship with him. Absolutely, we praise God for that. Amen. Yeah. That's right, in the midst of the COVID, that we have family in both near and far that are safe. Absolutely, amen to that. Yeah. Very good. For the friends and acquaintances that he has given in the church here that have become family. Amen. And praise God for that. Amen. Yeah, all the way in the back. Yes, ma'am. For Jesus and God himself, is that what you said? Amen. That's the greatest gift that we have. Amen to that. Thank you, God, for that. Any others? Yeah. The unshakable hope that we have that he is in charge and ruling on his throne. Absolutely. We thank God for that. Amen. Yes.
I'm thankful to God because he reached down and brought me into his family, and he also brought me into this man's family, who has been a blessing to me for 45 years.
reached down into your life and blessed you with a family and a husband. Amen to that. Yes, Irene.
I thank God for 10 years clean and sober.
For 10 years clean and sober. We thank and praise God for that. Amen for his faithfulness to you and that. Amen. Thank you for sharing that. Others? That's right. Yep. And in the midst of all the restrictions that we face, that the Word of God remains unbound, living in us and guiding our lives in truth. Absolutely. Amen to that. Yes.
I am thankful that we can all gather together like this, free from fear and with.
That's right. That's right. That we can gather in the church in the security of the Lord and in hope and without fear. Absolutely. Amen. Any others? You got yourself a good list, folks, of things to be thankful for there. Let's say just a general prayer of thanksgiving together, and then we'll sing the hymn Praise and Thanksgiving after that, okay? So would you join your hearts with me in prayer? Father in heaven, giver of all good things, gracious and loving Father who blesses us with so many gifts in Christ Jesus himself and the Holy Spirit which lives inside of us. We thank you this year for the boundless blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Not only the good things that we see and benefit from, but also the trials that have called us to greater depths of faith and trust in you. We thank you for the church and for your living word that moves and breathes among us. May it guide this church and your church throughout the world in thanksgiving and honor and praise and hope and security that we find, all of which we find in Christ Jesus, in whose name we pray and give thanks. Amen. Let's rise and sing together Praise and Thanksgiving. What is the third article of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. What does this mean? I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith. In the same way, he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one true faith. May 95, now thank we all our God. Trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray the prayer that he has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Give thanks to the Lord, because he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us all. Amen. Let's sing together, Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Thanksgiving, I think you'd be getting more of us folks from the Church of Creston, because I think that Pastor Reiner is preaching here Sunday, And then maybe you get me again on Wednesday at noon for your Advent services, so you'll be ready to kick us out of here by the end of next week, I think. The Lord's blessings to you. Happy Thanksgiving to y'all.